to try something here, and I'm going to need some help. And because we're working with youth here, we don't want to over-exaggerate this. Now, I'm pretty confident you've all done this before, or most of you have, but I want to create something because it'll really tie in to what I'm trying to do here. And so we're going to start over here, and this is what's going to happen. I'm going to ask you to do some things, and when I ask you to do it, I want you to keep doing it. But I don't want you to over-exaggerate it. All right? This isn't the goal to try to be the person that kind of sets out above the crowd. Let it take care of itself. And again, this is something that's been done so many times. It's called a rainstorm. But I want to hear it in this room with 5,000 people. But again, just do it simple what I ask you to do. And don't start until my hand passes in front of you. And then after it does, keep it going. I'll come back. And what I ask you to do, just keep it going. And when my hand comes in front of you, then you'll change it up. I think you'll get it in a minute. We're going to start over here. Just want you to do this. Just random. Here we go. Ah, nice. Did you hear the nice rain here? Okay. Ah, nice and build. Very nice. The beauty of a crowd. Very nice. We're talking about calling, and what I want to do is I want to lower some expectations, if that's okay. Because anytime someone gets up here to speak on a stage, or any time a person steps up to perform, expectations go up. We carry them all the time in our lives. We do it in relationships. When we feel like we're falling in love, we have those expectations. When we go to a classroom and we hear about a certain teacher, whether good or bad, we build expectations. But here's something I've learned about them. Anytime you set an expectation, you usually go away greatly disappointed. And so I want to lower those just a little bit. And I'm going to tell you two stories, absolutely true stories. And the first one comes out of the University of Colorado, Denver, Colorado, a young student there who liked to take the weekends, and what he would do is he'd go through the local newspaper and he'd look for automobiles, vintage automobiles for sale. He would inquire to see if somehow he could get the privilege to drive them. Playing a little game, knowing he could never afford them, he would still inquire, and many times he would have an incredible weekend of driving a vintage car. On a certain weekend, he looked through the newspaper and he found, this is back in the 80s, 1983, metallic blue, less than 10,000 miles, Mercedes-Benz. And so there was a phone number and there was an asking price of $50. Now he knew that that was a misprint, probably $50,000. But he called, the lady answered the phone, said, sure, come on over, I'd love you to drive the car. So he went over, took the car out, on an amazing afternoon, brought it back, handed the keys back to the lady, and she said, well, don't you want to buy it? And he says, ma'am, I couldn't afford it. She says, I'm only asking $50. This young student ripped out his wallet as fast as he could, handed her two crisp $25 bills, laid it, just making sure you're listening, and handed her the cash and grabbed a hold of the key and says, ma'am, I don't mean to be negative, and I don't mean to hurt your feelings, but you're not very smart. You know what this car is worth? She says, son, I understand what you're thinking, but you need to know the rest of the story before you pass any judgment. He said, ma'am, please enlighten me. She said, you have to understand, my husband is a very, very wealthy lawyer in town. 2 weeks ago, he ran away with his secretary. It broke my heart. This past week, he sent me a letter, and he said, would you sell my car and send me the money? See, now that is a guy who has great expectations that's going to come away greatly disappointed. You'd agree, right? Another true story. It's actually an insurance claim, and it was sent again by a lady. And I'm not going to quote it exactly, but let me paraphrase it. This is how it went. Dear sirs, I got up in the morning to get ready to work. My husband was already off to work because he always gets up before I. She said, I went to the bathroom to do what I normally do in the bathroom. I went to hairspray my hair, and the can was empty. So I picked up a brand new can, sprayed my hair, and when I set it down, it wouldn't shut off. So using my intellect, I lifted up the toilet seat, stuck the can down there, let it drain its entire contents, shut the lid, threw the can in the trash, went off to work. It must have been around lunch that my husband came home. And I knew he must have come home for lunch because he had stuff still out on the counter. But while he was fixing lunch, he felt the need to go to the bathroom to do his manly thing. When he sat down in the toilet, he thought it was a good time to light up a cigarette. When he did, the entire toilet exploded, throwing him into the wall, breaking his collarbone, and fracturing three ribs. Now, see, that's a man who sat down expecting absolutely nothing. Would you agree? And he got completely blown away, all right? So that's what I want this to be. I want this to be an opportunity because I'm going to share with you a story from my life. I'm 47 years old, graduated from high school in 1983, pretty much when most of you were not even born or thought of. And so during this time of my life, I moved from the state of Nebraska to Texas. And I had the privilege of doing something that I would pretty much clarify and guarantee that everybody in this room, especially you young guys, would love to be able to do and say about your life. What I'm about to tell you, you're going to have a hard time believing it's even true. But it was an amazing moment that changed everything about my perception in the world, how I see myself, the world around. It is the coolest thing that I had the privilege to do. After high school and graduation, I went to Texas. I went to a small school down there, and if you've ever been to Texas, you'll know that Interstate 35 cuts right down out of Kansas through Oklahoma, crosses the Red River, and when it goes into the state of Texas, the first community you come to is called Gainesville, Texas. When you get to Gainesville and you turn east, you go about 45 miles to a community called Sherman Denison. It's the Texoma area. Lake Texoma is there. And they have a newspaper. And I had enrolled in a junior college called Grayson County Community College. And it had 2 weeks before classes started. How I got there is just, it's not important for the moment. But I enrolled in this junior college. And I thought, how cool would it be to just maybe get a job, see if there's something out there. So I took out the Texoma News, which is the newspaper. It takes care of that entire area. And in the town of Gainesville, it said apply in person. This was on a Friday that I was looking through the newspaper. And the dates that it was set was the next day, Saturday, apply in person, a local zoo, baby animal zoo. And it said you can work for 2 weeks. It's a two-week job. I thought, wow, God has really given me an incredible gift. And so I thought, how cool would it be to say I worked at a zoo without even thinking that this is Texas, there's a lot of people living down there. When I showed up the next morning and they were taking applications, it was like the whole state showed up to apply to. And so I stood in line, still kind of hopeful, thinking, I don't know how many people they're going to hire at this moment, but I thought, how cool would this be if I could get this job? So I stood in line and I met this other kid. His name was Troy. And Troy and I stood in line together, and we just started kind of talking, and he's about my height and about my build and really nice looking. And so we're just kind of hanging out there a little bit, and I'm thinking, wow, this guy's cool, and he has one of those southern, you know, accents, and I've never been to Texas before. And so this was really kind of a cool thing. We're standing in line, and we're in front of a glass building that's about 100 yards in length, and you've probably seen them, 2-3-story building, all glass, where you know they can see out, but you can't see in. The line isn't moving, we're getting bored, and we started learning something. If you press your lips against windows and you blow, your mouth will accelerate like 2 times the size. You go, you know it? And we really became artists. we started putting our lip prints up against the window, and it was like so cool. And we started creating this unbelievable art, and the people are having fun. We're laughing, we're giggling, and this goes on. The line is like barely moving, and all of a sudden, Troy's like, you know, man, I've never met anybody from Nebraska. And I said, I've never met anybody really from Texas. And he says, what do you say we go to a McDonald's and get to know each other and don't go there? But anyway, so we turned to walk away, and this is when our lives changed. Now, I'm a person that doesn't believe in making fun of people. I find it really cruel. But we had something happen that just literally changed the course of my life. I don't know if you've ever seen The Wizard of Oz. If you've ever seen the mayor, he's about this high and about as wide as he is tall, and he's wearing that little black suit. And I'll tell you, I never believe in making fun of people. I have a sister who's born crippled, and I saw the cruelty of it. But when I turned around, it threw me off. And this is really what happened. We're sitting there, and we're getting ready to walk away, and we're thinking we're not going to get the job. We have lip prints all over the windows. They look really cool. We're pretty proud of ourselves. And we turn, and there's a tap on our shoulder. And I turned around, and there was no one there. I mean, that guy was that little. And I don't know, a little eight ball, you know, someone rolled him up. And he tapped us on the shoulder, and I turned around and went, whoa! You know, and he goes, we want to talk to you. And I said, the witch is dead. You know, it's the first thought I had. You know, it was a bad thought, I know. It was a bad thought. But he didn't think it was funny. Troy did, but... and he said, follow us. And I looked at Troy and said, follow the yellow brick road. You know? And he rolls out in front of us, and he walks right by everybody. We turn, go down the length of the building, go in the doors, cut down a hallway that's now paralleling. And when he takes us into an office, you can see our lip prints all over the windows. You know, we stood for a moment. It's like, wow, that's good. And embrace it. He rolled, this guy was so little, he rolled behind his desk and disappeared. And there must have been a little steps back there because he steps up there, puts his hands on the desk, and tells us to be seated. The guy has like no attitude either. And he tells us to be seated. So we sit down. He starts calling people into his office. We're thinking, wow, man, we can clean him up, you know. He tells us to be quiet. We're sitting in this chair in front of this guy's desk, this little sawed-off guy looking at us, and people start lining up behind us in sort of a semicircle, hands behind us, like, what is going on? He says, we've been watching you. Out the window, he's like, no kidding, man. He's like, I'll clean him. He says, no. We've been watching you. We want to give you the job. We think you two are perfect for what we want to ask you to do. But what we're going to ask you to do, if you don't want to do it, we've never met. This conversation never happened. We will completely deny that we ever met you. I'm thinking, man, what are we, smuggling drugs in a zoo? I mean, you know, whoa. You know, it's a little weird. And we're sitting, and these people behind us, they're just standing there. They're not even laughing. They're just like in a military, really serious pose. And he says this. He says, we want to show you and ask you. Now, what I'm about to tell you, you're going to make no way. But this is the coolest thing. It is so a dream job. He rolls across the floor. Literally, I'm not kidding. Rogart goes to a closet, opens it up. He comes out with this costume, lays it on his desk, and here's what he says. 1983, August of 83. He says, we're going to pay you $15.50 an hour to put on this costume and set in a cage. He said, we had a gorilla die. It takes 2 weeks for us to get a new one in, to fly into DFW, the airport. We need, listen to this. He says, we want you to put on, you guys are perfect. We've been watching you. It's the craziest thing. He says, I want you to put this on, trust us. $15.50 an hour. Now, I'm thinking that. This is 1903. He says, here's the deal. It's an eight-hour day for our zoo to open. But because this is Texas, you can imagine the warmth of putting this thing on. You work 4 hours. You'll work 4 hours, but we're going to pay you both for eight. For 40 hours in the week. For 80 hours in 2 weeks. I was like, this is my mom's going to be so proud. I was so excited. And so Troy doesn't think that, he's like, you're kidding me. But I'm like, man, I'm from Nebraska. What do they care? You know, I'm thinking 1550, man, I put this thing on, and I got to tell you, either the people in Texas are just flat out don't get life, because I don't look like him. I'm just standing here like, man, what, did I buy this at Walmart? You know, what these people behind us were literally people who design costumes that work with people. And so they took an impression of my jaw, put this mask on. It didn't even look like, it looked like a human being. They went away. An hour later, the people, they're already telling all the people to go home. We're the only ones there. They took an impression of my jaw, brought it back, fitted this thing in that I could move. It was unbelievable, this entire mouthpiece. They started puttying this thing to my eyes. They put this dye in my eyes because it needs to look bloodshot. If you've ever been close to a gorilla, they started building this costume. They had an entire mirror. I'm standing in front of this, and literally in an hour or so, I am transformed. Troy can't believe this. I'm still thinking 1550 an hour, man. This is big money. They brought a lady in who is a gorilla speech therapist. No kidding. She was like hyperactive too. She's like, all right, you ever play football? I was like, yeah. She goes, breakdown. I was like, what are you, lady? She goes, breakdown. So I went, oh. She says, now roll your shoulders forward. Put your arms in the middle like this. Just let your head cock up. She says, now I want you to get all this air in your stomach and just blow it out. And I said, you don't want me to do that. It was a good breakfast. She goes, no, the other end. You know? And so I'm sitting here, and I just, ooh. And she began to teach us. We watched videos and how they eat and how they talk. If you ever watch a gorilla, they just have one sound. When they're excited, ooh. When they're mad, ooh. Like, explains a bunch of junior high boys. But anyway, there's always one kid goes, oh. I couldn't believe this. This goes on, and I'm telling my mom. Then they said we couldn't tell anybody. I'm like, my mom, she would be so proud. I came to something, you know? But I couldn't even tell. I thought it'd be really cool, you know? To wear it on the way home, you know, get stopped by a radar cop. Can I see your license? So we had to take this thing off, and this is on a Saturday now, and the shift starts on Monday. I'm in, Troy's in. We had to sign papers, just so you know how serious this was. We had to sign papers that we couldn't talk to anybody, tell anybody. So my mom asked, did you get the job? I said, yeah. She goes, what are you doing? I said, well, I'm working at the zoo, you know? I couldn't even talk about it. Monday, I'm the first one up. We literally just did the old thing, flip the coin, who goes first? So I'm going to work the first 4 hours, and the zoo opens at 9, and then Troy's going to work the second 4 hours. So I had to get there quite early because it takes a lot to put this thing on. They had two costumes so they could get Troy ready when they need to make the shift out right after lunch. And so I put this thing on. It was so cool. So cool. They get me to my cage, and it's a semicircle of cages that are sitting just off, if you will, from the main gate. You can look across the grassy area, and you can see where the main gate is, and there's cage after cage on either side of me. They put me in it, and it's been cleaned up. And thank goodness the other one died. But so they cleaned up. There's a little pond down here, and there's some trees and stuff, and right in the middle is a tire, and I jumped up. But one of the things they told us, they said, don't do anything. Just sit there. Gorillas are not hyperactive. They're just, so I didn't tell them I was ADD on the steroidal side. So I'm in the tire, and I'm just sitting here thinking, this is awesome. wow. I couldn't believe 50 an hour. So I'm sitting here, and the zoo opens. And I watch this family come through, and a little boy has a bag of popcorn. He comes running across right to my cage, which I thought that was a little strange. So I'm just sitting there looking at him, you know. And I know this because I checked it out. Right up in the corner of my cage says, don't feed the animals. Now, this is why I learned so much about human nature. This little kid looks at the sign, reaches in his popper and goes, I came this close to going, read the sign, you know. See this little kid? But I didn't. I'm sitting there, and I'm just thinking, wow. And they kept saying, don't move. I was like, I have to. So I jumped down, and I just kind of moved over by this little kid. And I reached out, and they told us that, they showed us how gorillas eat. Gorillas don't pick things up. They actually, what they do is they lick their hands, and then they pack the food into the hand, and then they lick it out. So I reached down here, and I put it in my hand, and I put it in my mouth, and I looked at this kid, and he looked at me, and this is what happened. 1983, the August of that year, this is in Gainesville, Texas. I look at this kid, and I go, ooh. And this little kid, no kidding, goes, ooh. I was like, moron, you know. He yells and says, Mom, Dad, come over. Mom and Dad, come over. And they're standing with their little child. He's like, what? Jesus, what? Throws popcorn in. Dad looks at the sign. They're all excited. So I put some more in, ate it. And no kidding, I just looked at him and went, ooh. And in unison, Mom and Dad look at each other, little boy, and they all go, ooh. It was so cool. This goes on. And I'll speed up the afternoon. We're bored. They move on. They go do some things. I'm in the tire. And I can't tell you how it happened. Somehow I got to swinging. And it's a good thing no one was at my cage, because you know how we learn to swing. You know? I don't think gorillas do that. Somehow I got just bored, and I was swinging. And you know how momentum is. When you get close to something, you kick off. And so I got to swinging, and I thought, wow, I'm going to get some momentum going here. Totally forgot what I'm doing. And I kick the bars next to me, and I go, bam, and it shoots me back across the deal. It was cool. But the bars rattled, just, and when that happened, out of the next cave came this huge lion. I mean, I don't even know what kind it was. Huge lion comes out and starts running around the cage, And I'm thinking, this is supposed to be a baby animal zoo. The first thought I had was, what gave birth to you? You know, this thing's huge. And it's running around the cage, just going ballistic. And the people, of course, you know what people do. They hear roars. They hear that stuff. They come running back. And they're just like, yeah, you know, just they're just having fun. They're just like, something's good going to happen. And I'm like, this is entertainment mode. So I get it by the bars again. I'm just like, wah! Rattle, the lion runs around, I swing across, people are like, yeah, you know, it's just so fun. I can't even tell you how many numbers. I come down, now obviously what I'm about to tell you, it worked out, but I came down, when I kicked the bars the next time, the tire shot back, I didn't. And when I realized, when I kind of, the whole situation came in, somehow I got propelled. There's a bar here, I'm half in my cage, half in this lion's cage, and I'm just sitting here, and I'm looking at the people, you know, and all of a sudden, I'm thinking, you know, no big deal, I'll just slide out, and I tried to wedge it the way a gorilla might. They didn't teach us this, so I'm trying to pull, and I don't know if you've ever been hit by a cat, but I'm not talking Garfield here, okay? Good thing the bars were close, because this lion had come around and reached out with its paw, grabbed the back of my head, and I hit those bars, so I just went, bam, and everybody multiplied. And I thought this was my first thought. This is really sad to tell you. My first thought was, I'm not going to get paid. I mean, all I've had is $15.50 an hour. I'm sitting in this bars like this, and my head's exploded, and I'm doing this. And this is what they heard back in Gainesville, back in 83. This is what they heard. It was so wild. I'm looking out. People are about 15 yards from me. I'm caught in these bars, and this is what they heard. Help! Just as loud as I could. I'm just like, I'm going to die. And I'm grabbing the bars as fast as I can. The people were like, it was so strange. And then it's like they didn't care. They're just like, kill it, you know? They're waiting for something to happen. I'm just doing this as much as I can. I'm going to die. And that dumb lion gets right in my face and says, would you shut up, or we're both going to get fired. All right, listen now. what I just told you. There is a zoo in Gainesville. I've been there, but that's pretty much the whole story. It's true. Now, hang in here. Because actually the story I just told you is true. It may not be for my life. It was at one point. But I've learned it's true for a lot of you. I've discovered in our world, even adults get up every morning and zip on a costume and become something they're not. Because the price is really high. The stakes are really high. It's been said at this conference, the stakes have never been higher than they are today. Our world is desperate for people to be who God created them to be, and yet so few want to be that person. And a costume goes on, and young people, I see it in your lives, and every morning you get up, you zip on a costume, become something you're not because of unbelievable fear. You've learned to put bars out in front of you. You've learned to keep people at bay because you want to be accepted, you want to have value, you want to matter, and I watch adults do it. And they hide behind careers, they hide behind relationships, and when the relationship isn't good enough, they check out and find a new one. Every addiction, everything in life is search for something that cannot satisfy. Only one can. And I've watched this happen. And all I want to do is I want to take this story and tell you two things I've learned, not only about my life, but I've learned about people who truly make a difference, people that truly have value and give value, people that understand they matter and allow others to matter. I've learned two things. And the first is this. They know who they are. And they're okay with it. They love who they are. They're okay with who they are. The question to you. See, I believe there's a good God. I don't believe he's a religious God. I believe he's a relational one. I believe he's personal. I believe he's the all creator. He made you just the way he wanted you to be. He didn't want you to be anybody else. He wants you to be you. He needs you to be you because he only has one of you. And yet I watch people thinking, boy, if I could just get on the stage and speak, if I could just stand with a guitar and lead music, if somehow I could write a book, if I could make it to Hollywood, then I would be somebody, and you would for a moment, but the only problem is everybody out there is telling you who you are. And there's still something missing. You're still not okay because you're trying to get something out there that only Christ can do in here. It's an amazing thing because until you find your identity, you'll always lead with insecurity. Who you are in Christ. And this is a moment of impact. See, there's a story that comes out of the late 70s. It's by the name, a guy's name, Jim McLaren. Jim McLaren was considered to be the great hopeful for the United States Olympic team in the marathon. He'd been an incredible athlete, incredible successes. And for the first time, America was thrilled to the fact that not only we might have someone standing on the podium, but someone who could win gold. And weeks before the Olympics, Jim McLaren was in New York City riding his motorcycle when he was blindsided by a taxi. In the wake of the accident, he lost one of his legs. You can imagine what he went through, because up until this point, his identity had been found in his ability to run. And when that was taken away, he collapsed. Deep, dark depression. But something began to happen, and Jim McLaren learned a secret in life. Before I give you the secret, let me finish the story. He got a prosthesis, an artificial leg. He learned to walk. He learned to somewhat run again, knowing he would never, ever compete at an Olympic level. He entered the New York City Marathon to prove to himself, I can still finish. 3 miles into the race, his leg broke off and fell to the ground. For the next 23 miles, Jim McLaren hopped on one leg and finished the race, dead last. Dead last. Hours after the person before, he fell to the ground in utter exhaustion, and he said these words, "The only person I'm competing against is myself. The only person I have to beat is me." And that's true for everybody in this room. And yet it's so easy to make an art of putting bars in a cage, isn't it? And to entertain and keep the people far enough away, because if they get to know the real you, they may not like you, but that's okay. The question is, do you like you? Because that's the person God made, and it's the one that God will use in a mighty way. Back in the 60s, Bob Dylan, Pete Seeger, collaborated on a song that I think is so prophetic. I won't sing it, just give you the words. Little boxes on the hillside, little boxes made of ticky-tacky, little boxes, little boxes, little boxes all the same. There's a green one, there's a pink one, a blue one, a yellow one. They're all made out of ticky-tacky, and they all look just the same. The people in the houses, they go off to a university, and they all get put in boxes. Little boxes all the same. There's doctors, there's lawyers, there's business executives, and they're all made out of ticky-tacky, and they all look just the same. And the song goes on and continues to repeat itself. And I see it so often, I even see it in the church. This is what a Christian looks like. This is the way they're supposed to act. This is the way they're supposed to think. And we stick them in boxes. And I sometimes wonder if we're taking out the unbelievable creation of God and creating people the way we think they should look instead of letting God do his amazing work. For I've never changed a life, but I know one who can. And he can use them in mighty ways. Oscar Wilde, the famous playwright, said this, "Be yourself, everybody else is taken. I don't want you to be me. You would never be a good me. I like being me. And I need you to be you, and more importantly, God needs you to be you. He made you with loves and likes and opinions and ideas and passions. And when they come together with unbelievable love and work together in unity, the world will never be the same. And the body of Christ is truly beautiful and complete." People that make impact, people that are successful, and the ones that God just changes the world with, they know who they are, and they love it. For Jesus said what? Love your neighbor as yourself. Here's the second thing. They know where they're going. Maybe they don't have the career completely set in stone, but they know where they're going. See, John Maxwell says you start with the end, and then all your decisions point in that direction. See, I know where I'm going. I'm going to be with God in glory. And if I'm going to be in God in glory, then I'm going to step back here and make sure that my life is moving in that direction, the decisions I make. And I want to take as many people with me as the person that God made me be. Josiah the cat had incredible words of wisdom to Alice, didn't he? If you don't know where you're going, Alice, any road will get you there. And I see so many people, even God's children, taking that road, going absolutely nowhere. If you aim at nothing, you'll hit it every time. It's an unbelievable thing that God has given us called life. And God has a calling on every one of you. Not one of you is a mistake. Every one of you is a gift from God. God wants to do amazing things through you. And God can because he's God. He birthed you at the exact place at the right time. And for whatever reason you came in the world, you need to know this. Maybe you weren't planned by your parents, but you were planned by God. And he put you when he needed you here. And it's an incredible thing, that God has for you. And I want to show you how this works out. I want you to see this unfold personally before your eyes. And I want to come back. I'm going to wrap this up. Why don't you look at the screen, watch this.
I'm Tara Faber. At 18, I left my home in Iowa and went to St. Louis to pursue a music degree. I was positive that I was meant to be a famous singer, and I put every ounce of my thought and time into that goal. I spent an entire year in Germany working on an album for BMG, and then I was dropped from the label. But it would only be a few months later until my management team got me another record deal with the largest label in the world, EMI. I was now on the roster with some of my favorite bands, the Beatles, Coldplay, Joss Stone, Pink Floyd. I mean, I was stoked and I was ready to rock and roll. I had found my identity in being this artist, and I had sacrificed everything for it. I left my family, broke up with my boyfriend, dropped out of college to chase this dream. I was not gonna quit. Then, right when I thought things were going great, everything changed. My project was stopped, and I was once again dropped from the label. So, with nowhere to go, I was told to just move home. I had lost my identity, and with that, all of my confidence.
My name is Travis Jacobs. I grew up in a small town, and ever since I was a kid, I always felt like I wanted to do something big. So I pursued a career in being a DJ, and I also pursued a drug addiction, and I had gotten my girlfriend pregnant at the time. Over the next 2 years, I saw everything come about that I thought that I always wanted. I had the number one show, I was getting awards, people were literally handing me money. I was getting bonuses all the time. People were also giving me drugs all the time. I could walk into any bar and drink for free. I remember waking up one morning to a loud crash and hearing someone fall on my kitchen floor. And when I went in there, they had started experiencing this overdose from the drugs, and their teeth were clenched tight and the foam was coming out of their mouth. And I remember trying to get inside in between their clenched teeth to pull their tongue out so they wouldn't choke on it. That kind of stuff was going on in my house while my little girl was sleeping upstairs in her crib. I started losing friends. They started losing their lives. Some of them started going to prison. I lost my job. My fiance broke off the engagement. So I'm 27 years old, and I moved back into my parents' house with my daughter in tow. I remember many nights putting her in her crib, looking down at this beautiful little girl, and she's looking up at me, and she's looking to me to provide everything for her, to take care of her, to protect her. And I remember thinking, I can't even take care of myself.
My family called me one Saturday night and told me that they were going to a new church in Sioux Falls, South Dakota, called Celebrate, and they wanted me to come along. I said I would go and didn't think really much of it.
My sister, who had been going to a church, invited me to come to this church. So I was interested, and I went to this church, and I see the first picture I see when I walk in the back is a line of people of all walks of life. I see a guy in a business suit standing next to a biker dude, and everybody's hanging out. And I thought, this is a place where everyone's welcome.
Now, I don't remember what series they were in or exactly what the message was that day. But what I do remember is how I felt. And for the first time in years, I felt loved.
And I hear the pastor start talking about a relational God, and this God loves me. And I hear the pastor talk about how he's not perfect himself. And I thought, it's the first time I've ever heard a pastor say that he's not perfect. God loves us. He wants to have a relationship with you.
I'd never heard anyone preach like that before. I knew at that exact moment that God was real and that he loves me so much, just the way I am.
When I'm who God created me to be, my life matters. It makes a difference. And when I think about Pastor Keith and the fact that he is who God created him to be, and he answered what God asked him to do, and since he answered what God asked him to do, now I can come to a place called Celebrate Church and learn about a God that loves me and be who he created me to be.
I know who I am now, and more importantly, I know whose I am. And now I know that my life matters.
Anything else? God is good. What else is there?
I want you to welcome Tara and Travis. Sometimes when I see stories unfold in video, when I watch it on television, I sometimes wonder, are these real people? And that's why I wanted them here, because they're real people. But they're not just a story that God rescued from the past. God always has so much more for us. We're not taking up space. You're not an accident. You're somebody, as the Bible tells us, was wonderfully, specifically, uniquely handcrafted by God, breathed with the very breath of His life into yours. And there's something He wants to do with it. Folks, life is not planet Earth. There's a whole lot more to come. And we're passing through. But the unbelievable impact that God wants to do through our lives is staggering. There's so much talk about all the unrest and the struggles going on within this country itself, economically, socially, spiritually, but I believe these are the best days that we're in right now. This is a moment for God's people to watch God be God. We've had it so good. We've got comfortable. It's been so easy. But we get to be the church today. And I believe right now, the best days for the church are sitting out here. When young people who understand who they are and they're okay with the person God made and knowing that God has a plan that's like no other. The prophet says, I know the plans I have for you. The question is, do you want to know? Folks, I would rather want to walk in what God has for me than anything I could dream up myself. God has incredible plans. See, the reason I wanted them here is God didn't just find them. God has done unbelievable things in these two lives. Two people that put God out in the pasture, didn't want anything to do with them. And God began to do something. And it's not about where they've been, it's where they are right now and where they're going. And the reason I wanted them here, because God didn't just save them. They're on my staff at Celebrate, and both of them sit in very significant executive roles, leadership roles. And what God's doing with their lives, it blows their minds to think that God has called me. Where I've been, why would He call me? But I have that question too. I know where I've been. Why would God want to use me? And the fact that I get to do what I do every day blows my mind. Now, is there moments that it's difficult? Yes. Is there moments that I still struggle? Yes. But I'm so grateful for a guy named Mark Gorvette, who's here, president of Kingswood. So grateful that he took a chance on me, introduced me to a church denomination I didn't even know existed. And now I get to be a part of a church plant. Been there 13 and a half years, 14 come this May, and literally have watched thousands of people come to Christ because God is not done with Keith Loy, and He's not done with you. You hear this. Wayne Cadero is the senior pastor out in Hawaii, church out there that's just reaching thousands of people. And I remember being here in this place, in Louisville, at a Wesleyan conference. And he shared something that is just unbelievably true if you can grab hold. He said, you know, it's interesting in track and field. There's an event called a relay. Four people run. And anybody that knows track and field knows that the last one to carry the baton is always the fastest one in the team. They're the best athlete. They call it the anchor leg. And in our world today, there's a lot of talk about us being in the end times. If that's true, do you understand that you're God's best? This is God's anchor leg. And young people, you're the best. God has unbelievable things for His church, and it's right here. When you will early on accept before God who you are, whose you are, and know that He has a plan, and I know where I'm going, and I'm going to take as many people as I can. We are so privileged to have schools like IW, OW, Southern, Houghton, Kingswood, schools that are committed to raising young people. And if there's ever a time you need to be careful where you're going, I will guarantee you it's that. An opportunity to be incubated in some ways, to be taught the Word of God, to be given tools that can change the world. and be about the Father's business, whether it's in ministry full-time, but wherever you're at, if you're a child of God, you're in full-time ministry. But the choice is yours. The choice is yours. There's a story by Edward Markham, the poet. He says, a certain rich man, it seems, wanted to do something good. One day he was walking through the streets and he saw a very poor house. In it, he knew, lived a carpenter who had a very, very large family. After some deep thought, the rich man went to see the carpenter and gave him plans for the most beautiful house in town. He asked the carpenter if he would build him such a house on a very lovely piece of property he had overlooking a nearby river. I want it to be as fine, as sturdy as possible, he said. Use only the best materials and employ only the best workmen. Spare no expense to make it the finest house in town. He said he was going on a journey and hoped the house would be ready upon his return. Well, the carpenter saw his chance. Other men with the same opportunity would make plenty for themselves. Why shouldn't he? So he skimped on the materials. He employed inexperienced and inexpensive help and covered their mistakes with paint. So when the rich man returned, the house was finished. I followed your instructions, he lied. I completed the house as you told me. I'm glad, said the rich man. Here are the keys. The house is yours. I had you build a house for yourself. Now you and your family may live in it. And I contend the same is true with your life. I love the church. I love the body of Christ that says, I can belong in it and I'm accepted just the way I am. A little crazy, steps over the line, pushes envelopes, gets selfish, reacts when he should respond. But I love being in a place that says, we just love you for being you. And I love the fact that I get to love people the same. And to watch so many people, young people, old people, discovering who they are in Christ and saying, I'm okay with being me. And passionate about giving their lives away. And to think where Travis was. Had money, had fame, had everybody telling him he was okay, but he knew he wasn't. Strung out in drugs, watching friends of his die from him. As a little girl. And he's one of the most great fathers that I know. Tara, an amazing vocalist, an amazing gift that could easily make in all kinds of financial, unbelievable returns. And how many days I'll watch her up there singing and tears running down my cheeks thinking, wow. And she does a concert literally every week before thousands and gets to tell them about the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Your life matters. And God's got an amazing plan, and it's better than anything the world could offer or you could think of yourselves. But he says, you get to choose. It's your house. How are you going to build? Go back to school this spring and try to fit in with a group of people that 5-6 years from now won't even know you exist. Play a game with all kinds of things on the outside that you think can satisfy to try to fit in again one more time. Putting the bars up, imprisoning yourself and zipping on a costume and giving your life away to what? When God says, take it off. I already clothed you in unbelievable beauty, just the way you are. But you got to take the key. You got to take the key. And that's what I'm going to ask you to do. How would you like to give your life away to something that matters? It has eternal rewards. Man, I love what I do. Because it matters. And I'm watching marriages get restored. I'm watching lost people be found. And I'm privileged to be a part of something that's so beyond anything that man thinks it could offer. And I'm so glad I took those keys. And I'm so grateful for a denomination that said, be you. And we'll watch God be God. And I'm going to invite the same for you. We have doors on either side of the stage. I'm going to ask Tara to be at one door, and I'm going to ask Travis to be another, because I love to watch the legacy of God's work as he passes on, takes a life, does his amazing, miraculous work. And I want them to pass you a key. The key is yours. The door is simply a picture of you of stepping out of side of the cage, taking off the costume and saying, God, I want to build on your word. I want to build. I want my life to be your life. And I'm going to trust. It's going to be an awesome journey. Is there pain? Absolutely. But God will use them wherever you've been. Last night was brilliant. It's not about where you've been. It's where you are right now. Where do you want to go? 80 years will be 80 years. Wouldn't you like to look back one day and go, wow, wow, wow? You got to take the key. Step outside of the cage. And let's begin to watch God. Because right here is God's absolute best. And it'll change the world forever. We're going to invite you. I want to pray. And if God is speaking to you, and you feel a calling, and I'm not just talking specifically ministry, you're saying, man, I want my life to matter. I want it to be everything that God wanted it to be. Now I'm going to ask you to step out. I'm going to ask you to come, and you take this key, and let's watch God. Let's watch God change our world. The church, the body of Christ. Man, it's a beautiful thing. It's a beautiful thing. And let's not play church. Let's be your church in our generation. And let's bring it home. Amen? Let's pray. I'm going to ask you to stand. And I want to pray. Father, in this room, are your chosen. Your promises are true. God, you do not fail. You will not abandon us. You are so good. The plans you have for us. Paul said, I know whom I believeth, and I'm convinced he's able. He is. Because of you, we can do all things. Whatever choices we've made in yesterday, our yesteryear, it's about right now. The transforming, the unbelievable God with the work that you can do and how you take some of the unbelievable, sick and poor choices that Keith Boyd's made and use them for the good today. For eternal significance, it blows my mind. But that's who you are. God, what an offer you give us. The life you gave us. You didn't call us to be anybody else, but the person that you made, beautiful, handcrafted specifically, uniquely by God. I know in this room, many, if not all, maybe the future just looks a little gray, skewed at best. What is God going to do? The good news is this, it's going to be grand. And you'll show us just enough. We walk and trust you and let you be God. It's unbelievable. I cannot believe I get to do what I do because of you. God, I say thanks. And Lord, I pray that these young people, adults like in this room, will accept the call to come and take the key and say, I'm going to build this. As Joshua said, as for me and my house, we will serve. We will stand. We will walk in the boldness, the trust of who you are and watch you unfold the unbelievable future, the one you have for me. God, that's all I want. God, this is a moment of impact, a decision that will change the world forever. Change the world forever. Will you come? Will you take a key? Will you step outside through the door? And will you say, God, keys to the house you gave me. I will build on you. I will trust. I want to be everything you want me to be. And the world will never be the same. As you walk through the doors, just stay to the outside. There's counselors in the back that want to talk to you. They have more things they want to do with you. Will you come? Will you come? It's in your hands.